The riffs are too repetitive, the lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides and the cover art's a mess. There's so much here to tear apart. Listen to it for a week, now that week has passed. Why I hate this album podcast with Tim and Garrett.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Why I Hate This Album. I am one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey. With me as always, Mowgli to my Baloo, co-host extraordinaire Timothy Richardson. Tim, how are you doing?
Inconsistent.
Talking about your emotions?
Yeah, I've had a few really high highs, but they were few and far between this week.
Were your highs higher than your lows low?
No.
Why is it you're so emotionally conflicted on this roller coaster of sadness and utter despair?
Well, Garrett, this week we finally did it. We went full ska.
Full ska.
That's right. We're talking about Real Big Fish's Turn the Radio Off, released August 13th, 1996.
We finally said, you know what? It's been almost a year. Let's go full ska. And Tim, I'll just ask it. We went full ska. Did you hate it?
Not quite. I should hate it, and I tried to hate it, but I'm not quite there yet.
So if I were to refer to the Victrum Ross hatred scale, with, of course, a 93 being maximum hatred and a lowly 7 being minimum hatred, where do you think this sits currently before we dissect it on that scale?
Probably in the mid-70s.
Okay, so well past the halfway point, but a low C, maybe a high D.
Yeah, I do not care for this album. But what about you? Did you hate this?
Oh, Tim. That roller coaster you mentioned earlier, I've been riding it all week.
You love roller coasters, right? That's you?
Yes, I do love roller coasters.
So you love this week, is what you're saying?
No, I don't like emotional ones.
Oh, okay.
Or wooden ones.
They're scary.
They hurt my organs. They do. They are poorly maintained. But I'll get in it, because I love roller coasters. Let me say it this way. I have quite the personal history with this album, and that complicates the matter. It is an integral part of my youth.
Okay. So you hate it?
On a scale of 7 to 98, probably at an 80.
Oh, so higher than me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Let's start it at an 80 on that very traditional scale of 7 to 98, and we'll see where it takes us.
Okay.
Tim, is this the first time that your fish has been reeled?
I have actually quite a bit of history with this band as well.
Interesting.
I don't think I ever owned this particular album. I had their 98 album, Why Do They Rock So Hard? I remember enjoying it quite a bit. I also saw them in concert whenever I was 16. October 2001, I actually looked up the exact date. It was at a place called Numbers in Houston.
What?
The garbage punk band Alistair opened for them, and I remember smoking cigarettes with those idiots between sets because I was very cool. So I went back to their website, the concert venue's website, Numbers. It appears to be, at least in part, a sex club now. It might have been then as well. It's unclear what happened that night, but I want to give you a taste of what they're up to now.
Okay.
Kinky Tuesdays, a kinky collective for all things fetish. Come and join us every Tuesday with a night of play and fun while getting to know more fellow kinksters or merely dance to amazing music. They also have Kinky Circus for Halloween and a Kinky Christmas.
I get the impression, listening to that description, that during all of these various kinky events, there's a lot of ska being played.
Probably. From what I could tell from their website, up until 2015, it appears to be a fairly good, small concert venue. They had the Dandy Warhols play, and everything seemed to go to shit right after that. But before this, they had Iggy Pop, Nine Inch Nails, Alice in Chains, The Cranberries, Dinosaur Jr., allegedly Blind Melon's last show as a full band, Beck, Wu-Tang Clan, The Black Keys. My point is, it's not entirely a sex thing.
Well, maybe not then.
Right, but it also might have been entirely a sex thing then.
Absolutely, which begs the question, how is it that your life has become, especially at such a young age, so incredibly desensitized to erotic behavior in your general day-to-day surroundings that you did not even notice? To you, it was just a normal concert. People are sucking and fucking all around you in the weirdest way possible, and you're just like, boy, I really like ska. Who wants to skank?
Oh, skanking will come up.
Of course it will. We went full ska.
I mean, that's my history. What about you?
What's interesting about your experience with this band is that it happened so late in the band's fame. I would argue that ska was no longer of any interest to the rest of society by 2001.
Oh, absolutely not. Not by 98.
I was a huge fan of this band, and by that I mean I was a huge fan of this album. I have not heard any other album of theirs, nor did I seek it out. However, I got this album early 97 would be my guess, and Tim, this was a very important album to me. Not only did it lift my spirits and somehow I related to it, but it was part of a 3-album Get Pumped series that I would play before every one of my cross-country meets.
Oh, good God.
Little background, I ran cross-country for a bit there in high school until I realized weighing 135 pounds and being 6 feet tall is not a great look.
The pictures from your high school yearbooks are hilarious, though.
I look like an alien. You know what? I'm painting the wrong picture, Tim. I need to paint an accurate picture of the boy who owned this album. I owned it 8th grade, start of 9th grade. I was still listening to it in 9th grade before my cross-country meets, but that boy had not yet hit his growth spurt. I was a mere 4'8". No need to rewind, everyone. I'll say it again. I was 4'8", maybe and 1/2. For those of you living in Texas, by today's legal standards, at 4'8", I would be required to sit in a child seat.
At
my weight. 14 going on 15. Freshman year in high school. You think it's bad enough getting dropped off at school by your mom? What if she has to unbuckle you first? Take you out of your 6-point harness.
Keep in mind that a year after in my life, I was apparently going to sex clubs, smoking cigarettes with terrible punk bands.
And doing God knows what in that kinky club.
It was,
hey, can I get a drink? Sure, but you got to hold this first. All right. Nothing weird about this.
Nope.
Stick your face in this hole. Okie dokie. I am at a concert. Nothing weird about that at all. Would you wear this leather dog mask? I don't see why not. I'm at a concert. This is all
Garrett, I came
very
with
normal.
A leather dog
okay.
mask.
Okay. Oh my God.
I like doggies.
Podcast over. My point is, Tim, I had to get pumped up. So I had a 3-album in a specific sequence. It began with Nirvana, the Unplugged album, live in New York.
Well, that's not going to get you pumped up.
No, but it had to wake me up. This is just on the bus, right? So you finish that album, you get to the grounds, you start walking the course, and that's when you pop in disc number 2, Bush's 16 Stone. I need to mention, I am doing all of this on a Discman.
Oh, sure.
iPods were a bit down the road. I had a 40-second shock protection buffer, so it was pretty sweet. So then you got to start warming up for your race. That's when you go throw with the big guns. Real Big Fish, turn the radio off, time to get pumped. Now, it's crazy and alarming that that was the purpose of this album then versus my reaction to it today.
See, that makes sense to me. If you want something to get pumped up to, given your propensity for, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but being some sort of high school loser, this album has a lot of themes of just like, well, fuck you, I'll show you. Well, I'm probably going to be terrible, but I can do it, kind of. It seems like the perfect thing for you to listen to before you run a cross-country track meet and then get bullied, presumably.
It is the perfect combination of uncontrollable narcissism combined with an incredibly low self-esteem.
It sums you up then, it sums you up now.
Oh, sure. My ego is a colorful candy shell that protects me from the melting insecurities that live inside.
How very poetic.
And delicious. Coincidentally, I do have an M tattooed on my tummy. I don't know where it came from or what it stands for.
I know where it came from. I also do not know what it stands for.
Well, we're going to take that one off, Mike. So, Tim, I have quite the history. It did create some real emotional flashbacks for me throughout this album, kind of remembering how much fear and rejection I lived in those days.
I mean, I have to imagine you still have a lot of fear these days, though.
But I will not be denied.
Oh, dear God. I can only continue this friendship and this podcast if I don't know what that statement means.
We'll see. You have a history with it. I have a bit of a tortured past with it. I loved it. I want to make that clear. I loved it. Not only would I be sitting there on the bus listening to this and getting pumped, I would be consuming no less than one large meatball sub. You got to get your energy up if you're going to, and that's 100% true. Usually I had one sub for the bus and one sub for just before the race. I am beginning to think I did not have a traditional childhood.
Oh, Oh, Garrett, you were so abused for so many years and you didn't even realize. I guess your parents started out with abuse, so you just kind of grew into that and you just never really realized that this is not normal. And I am here to tell you, that was not normal.
Now, the meatball subs were my request.
I'm sure, but that was to fill the empty hole inside of you left by a lack of love and too much real big fish.
I thought it was just hunger.
That's how it manifests.
I'm still pretty hungry. Do you think that hole's still there?
Oh, God, yes.
I don't know why. I was expecting you to say something pretty positive there.
No, Garrett, while we have this opportunity, have you heard about Jesus?
Oh, come on. Stop trying to fill my holes with Jesus.
I won't.
We don't have time for this. You have a great history with it. I have a great history with it. But let's get to the history of this band. How did we get the band known as Real Big Fish?
We got here with the most boring story you're ever going to hear. They formed in 1991 as a non-ska cover band in Orange County, California. By 1992, they had recorded their first demo of original non-ska songs.
And it's pretty quick.
Especially since they were like literally just out of high school. They got the name Real Big Fish. So their original demo was entitled The Fisher King, Real Big Fish, after a movie.
It's got Jeff Bridges and Robin Williams.
No one gives a shit.
Well, okay.
The band's lead singer, Aaron Barrett, decided on Real Big Fish. The bassist, Matt Wong, said it was the most embarrassing thing that ever happened in the band. They planned to change the name, but it just never happened. So they were stuck forever with Real Big Fish, a name that at least several band members hated. The original singer leaves just after this demo is recorded. Aaron takes over, and under this sideburn aficionado's visionary leadership, they go full ska.
Did you happen to hear any of their pre-ska music?
No, couldn't find it.
Me either.
It's apparently quite rare.
I suspect it might be quite good.
You never know. In 1995, their first album, Everything Sucks, is released. The cover features Matt Wong's little sister possibly getting bitten on the tongue by a dog.
Does seem that way, doesn't it?
Yeah. The album features 21 songs, only four of which would not be re-recorded for subsequent albums. Like, they get sort of this underground following in Southern California. They end up getting a deal with Mojo Records based on this. In 96, the album of the week comes out. It's even more ska-y and punky than the original Everything Sucks. Then they go on a nationwide tour. The single Sell Out becomes a minor hit on MTV, but, you know, we shouldn't give the impression that they were ever really popular. They weren't.
Because when you read about them, it's written as though they were.
Yes.
Like, there's several articles that are like, and that's when they hit the mainstream. Not really.
I mean, they did hit the mainstream, just no one really bought it.
There was a ska craze that swept this nation, but it wasn't over Real Big Fish.
By 1998, the third wave ska thing had already basically been relegated to the dustbin of history, but Real Big Fish soldiers on. They released their album Why Do They Rock So Hard in 1998, and it does not sell as well as Turn the Radio Off, which, not to get ahead of ourselves, also didn't sell all that well, but I bought this album. The same year, they also cameo in Garrett's 11th favorite film of all time, Basketball, and record a cover of A-ha's Take on Me.
Oh my god, you're right, they did. It's just terrible.
After the 98 album, the drummer quits. One of their two tromboners is kicked out after battery charges are brought against him after a little mix-up with a security guard in St. Louis. They continue to release music and tour. With each album, people just give less and less of a shit. 2000 sees a covers slash parody album. In 2002, they release their first greatest hits album, Somehow. And then later that year, they release a new studio album. 2005 to 2006, they released their second greatest hits album, a live retrospective album, and another studio album. Then they get dropped from their record label. 2007 to 2009, they released two more studio albums, a cover album, and a live DVD.
My word.
2010, somehow, another greatest hits album is released. 2011, an acoustic greatest hits album is released.
Tim, we gotta get our hands on that. An all-acoustic Real Big Fish. It's a totally different band.
Yeah.
There is a chance. Now, I have not heard a single song of you.
No.
We cannot rule out that there's a minimum 5% chance. It's really good.
Yeah, but they are going to be playing all the songs from this album.
Never mind.
Yeah. 2012, they release another studio album. And then Garrett, 2018, 1 month in the future, their most recent studio album is released December 21st, 2018, entitled Life Sucks, Let's Dance. Just in time for Christmas. Hint, hint, wink, wink. Buy me that album.
Tim, I've got some bad news for you. I had to sell your stocking.
Oh.
Yeah.
But what do you mean?
I mean, you know the stockings we hang
yes.
over the fireplace that we drew on the wall?
Yeah.
Yours is gone because I sold it.
Why?
For money, Tim.
Oh, I'm selling your stocking. Give me your stocking.
No, my stocking is locked away safely in my stocking safe.
All right, I will sell the rest of your socks then. Aaron is basically the only remaining original member at this point. He said that recording the album with the current lineup was really fun. He says, we're going to make you laugh. We're going to make you dance. We're going to make you raise your middle finger. We're going to make you forget about your problems and live. Garrett, that is an album I need to hear.
Tim, he is lying to you.
Picture this album, but 22 years on.
Maybe all the horns players are dead.
They are, but he's got new horns players.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like a thing I ever want to hear, but I will.
Let's
not anytime soon.
Yeah.
All right, Tim. Excellent history. You were right. It couldn't have been less interesting, though. That moves us into general thoughts. What do you think of this album?
Garrett, this is hard to hate for a couple of reasons. The most important being, on a lot of these songs, they're clearly being sarcastic or joking.
I would argue the musical portions are not jokes, though.
Yes. It's kind of this weird dichotomy because I feel like they're using this sort of joking lyrics as a little bit of an excuse.
Much as a comedian would use a guitar to distract from the fact that his jokes are not so great.
Exactly. They're singing all these songs about how they don't want to be popular, but they clearly want to be popular so badly. It's filled with this relentless hipster irony that just wears on you after a while.
Their need to be liked could probably only be matched by a young 14-year-old boy that looked considerably younger and never got anyone to sit on the bus with him as they rode to the next cross-country meet.
Oh, God. You really were just a Forrest Gump.
What?
You couldn't have anyone sit next to you on the bus. You could run really fast.
Oh my God, you're right.
All the pieces are falling into place.
Except for the success and riches.
Well, that comes later, Garrett. You have not had your Vietnam yet.
Oh my God. Does it take place in Vietnam?
It does. It does. In the Second Vietnam War.
I agree, Tim. Let's break it down a little bit. Musically, talented people, right?
Sure. However, there's a lot of really lazy music on here.
Too many of these songs sound entirely too similar.
Yes.
What is there, 15, 16 songs on here?
Yeah, there's 16.
There's probably somewhere between 3 and 5 songs on here, and that's not even counting the content. We're speaking just musically. You want to talk about content, there's no more than 2 songs here. I never realized just how much music is written about people falling in and falling out of love.
On here, it's not even really that. It's incel music, Garrett. It's this whole, you don't want to date me? Well, fuck you. I never wanted to date you anyway. I'm happy all by myself, you fucking Chads and Stacys.
Tim, I love a good incel joke as much as the next guy or gal. But the familiarity, frequency, and use of specific lingo that I'm getting from your microphone these days is alarming.
I am a member of a series of communities, if you will, on Reddit, some other forums that, just are less frequented and maybe less mainstream. I go there so that I can keep up with terminology that may be useful for this very show. I would say that, again, as you said, the number of references I have made, all accurate references, proves that I am right to go to these websites every single day and post things and read countless hours of information about Chads and Stacys. Did you know, Garrett, there's now a Brad. A Brad is like a super Chad. Not only is he a ladies' man, he is a ladies' man with multiple ladies, Garrett. He has a bunch of Stacys in his stable.
First of all,
taking ladies from the rest of us, Garrett. What the fuck?
Okay,
this is why some people can't find love. It's not because their personalities are disgusting. It's not because they've never done anything to better themselves. It's not because they smell bad. Something they could easily fix. Garrett, it's not because
they're completely repulsed by people of the opposite gender.
Right. None of these things. It's the Brads and it's the Chads to a lesser extent, but mostly the Brads.
I don't even want to poke a hole, Tim. I just want to make an observation. You ruminate on it and make your own choices. I'm not here to tell you how to live. I mean, I am telling you how to live on a daily basis, but I just want to point out that you mentioned there's some sort of super Chad known as a Brad.
Yes.
Who has multiple Stacys in his stable.
Yes.
Have you ever known any Brad to have one Stacy, let alone multiple Stacys?
They're out there, Garrett. People on these forums talk about them constantly. Where would they be getting this information if it were not, in fact, factual? Are you a fucking Chad? Holy shit. You're a Chad.
You're an incel. I can't dance around it anymore. I thought there was a whole different thing going on. Nope. Turns out you're just an incel. Well, you might be a different thing too, but that's not for me to discover for you.
I don't
you.
Think that's true. I think I just enjoy hearing other people's stories. Their life experiences, their things they're going through that may bear some resemblance to mine, but I, you know, of course I'm no incel. That seems wrong.
I'm not going to defend my childhood or the lifestyle that I led, but at least I kind of pulled out of that nosedive. You seem to be pointed towards the ground and headed there quick, buddy. Is there something I can do?
No.
According to these forums, no. Okie doke.
Oh, back to the album.
Of course.
It's nice of them to announce that they are ska beforehand. They don't sneak it in. You know, they put it right up front. They're not subliming us.
We knew what we were getting into. And that's part of the reason I'm having a hard time bringing this all the way over to a hate. It'd be like screaming at a horse because it isn't a cow. It's not the cow's fault. He's not a horse.
Of course. Things are in different categories, sure. Some people are Chad.
Okay. No. Your categories are bullshit because your representation of the Uber male is a Brad. Good Lord, we have not heard from that kid in weeks. I guess he's having a good time at college.
Yeah, it's amazing to me that they would choose that name of all names, but
that's what makes me think the whole thing might just be made up garbage. The music is well played. These are mostly songs. The content varies in quality wildly, right? From mediocre to just pathetic.
Yes.
Are we calling this singing?
There's scatting.
This thing is scat-tastic.
There's a lot of weird vocal nonsense. It seems like there's a big defense mechanism on this thing. He never actually goes for it.
It's talk singing. Yeah. Mostly it's gibberish.
So I read what ska fans think of on some online forums that were next to some stuff I was reading earlier.
God, Tim, I am putting that parental block back on your computer.
Thank you. Please do. I cannot control myself. They really seem to be kind of polarizing in the ska community. I think part of the reason for that is that they're this jokey band. They're kind of poking fun at ska.
Yeah, kind of feels like they're making fun of their thing. I get it.
So I did the math. 7 out of 16 of these songs were released the year before on the album Everything Sucks. That's 44% of the songs on this album. This album is basically a greatest hits album.
I think it's hard to talk about this in any real meaningful way without referencing some specifics. But needless to say, we are conflicted. It's certainly not the worst thing we've had to deal with on this show, but it's not the best either. We are in the not hate category with an eye. I'm just looking to get there this week. Maybe we should say that. What are your intentions, Tim?
I would like for both of us to get there. I am excited about the prospect of getting there. I'm excited about the prospect of potentially getting you there.
And by that, of course, we do in fact mean getting us there to the point at which we hate it.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Just because some of the intensity and language you use is misleading. Let's get into it, Tim. Song number 1, Sell Out.
A question just right up front. How did they decide to name this song Sell Out? There are at least 6 other songs on this album that could have been named Sell Out.
I think in the other ones, they are willing to sell out, but don't get the opportunity.
Oh.
Whereas in this one, they are given the opportunity to sell out and question whether they should.
Well, I think they don't question it. I think they go for it.
Someone's questioning it.
The arc of the song seems to be him wanting to be famous and his, I think you're meant to assume, girlfriend. It just says she. We cannot rule out that it's his mom.
No, it's not his mother.
It might be his mother. She wants him to not sign the contract and says that he can be a fast food worker all of his life.
I guess she's saying, I know you can't work in fast food all your life, but don't sign this. This is not a good deal. And he's like, cool, but I did already.
Oh.
I thought you'd be excited, not mad.
Women are tricky to read. The idea of selling out seems to be one of the most common tropes in punk and ska music.
Well, yeah, because punk and ska music, Tim, as you may or may not know, is just rife with posers.
But there's a lot of songs that like directly address this. There was a 92 NoFX song, Please Play This Song on the Radio. Dead Kennedys, Less Than Jake, The Vandals all have had songs like this.
With this band in particular, I think that they are once again just saying it up front so no one else can say it to mock them.
I mean, it seems like a preemptive defense mechanism. It's sort of a way to admit that they want to be popular, but also have an excuse to fall back on that, oh, no, we're just doing it ironically.
The ironic thing to me in this song is that they're worried that people think they sold out, and they are, in effect, by their own admission, selling out and ready to cash in and make all of that mainstream money. But I don't think that actually happened.
No.
Financially, certainly not. You didn't sell out at all. You were marginally successful.
I hate ska guitar. Do you know what I'm talking about? It's the underlying rhythm guitar that doesn't really have a melody and only serves to provide a backdrop for horns to play over. I think it's completely unnecessary. Plenty of bands have successfully like integrated horns into normal music without sacrificing the rest of the band or going full ska.
Yeah, you never go full ska.
Modest Mouse did it really well with the Dirty Dozen Brass Band, for example.
Several bands have. Look at the fucking Rolling Stones.
Sure.
Judging this album, I technically like this song. I think it's among the better songs on this album.
Yes, this was a well-chosen single.
Having said that, it begins an overall criticism I have for the entire album, even though I think they're used well in this song. Too much horns. Real Big Fish, I hope you're listening. You got a new album coming out in about a month. Too much horns. Whatever horns you got in that one, reduce it by half. Real Big Fish and their new album, Half the Horns.
I like it. Do that acoustic, ska-acoustic thing and just cut out half the horns.
Ska-acoustic.
That might be what it's called. I don't know.
Oh, fuck whoever invented that.
It might be me. We don't know because I have not
looked
it up.
Then I stick by my statement. Song number two, Trendy.
This has the cadence of either a nursery rhyme or something to jump rope to.
Well, it's all over the map. To jump straight to the end, it turns into some sort of conga line style song. But way before that, there are some odd things going on in here. Let me ask you, do you know what this song is about?
Well, there's two things. The very opening seems to be they're insisting that there's some sort of dance craze called the Fish.
Mm-hmm.
That does not exist, as far as I know. I don't know, actually. Have you done the Fish, Garrett?
I've not done the Fish. I have Googled doing the Fish. Did you Google the Fish?
I didn't. I was afraid.
I Googled the Fish.
What would come up with if I Googled doing the Fish?
I took that journey for you, friend. Largely, it was not so bad. A huge waste of time. 6 hours, I won't get back. But
gotta be thorough.
The videos were mostly of like a mom like videotaping her 12-year-old being like, oh, look at Kevin. He looks like a fish.
Well, now I have to go look at this fucking videos.
No, don't. There does not appear to be a dance craze known as the Fish. So what are they saying here? Are they trying to start the Fish?
I think it's like one of those things where if I was just like, yeah, my name's Tim. You know, back in my old high school, people used to call me Laser. You can do that if you want. Like, I'm not saying you have to, just throwing it out. You're trying to give yourself a nickname.
I'm Cecil. Everybody calls me Dragon. No, they don't.
Yeah, and I think that's sort of what they're doing here. They're trying to will into existence a dance craze that does not exist.
So the song continues. They're espousing the benefits of being trendy in the weirdest way possible. I think there might be a chance that the Fish is a dance craze unique to the neo-Nazi punk movement.
Oh.
I didn't Google it because I don't want any part of that. The lines that follow the opening where they keep repeating that everybody's doing the Fish, it reads funny to me. I'm going to take the word trendy and I'm going to replace it with the word racist. You just tell me what you think.
I already love it.
It's not so bad being racist. Everyone who looks like me is my friend. Please don't hate me because I'm racist. They're not going to laugh at me again. One of us. One of us. One of us.
I knew those sideburns were suspicious the moment I saw them on this Aaron character. That fits.
When I say a neo-Nazi punk band, there's a whole neo-Nazi punk scene. Are you familiar with this?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, it's the
all right,
the hardcore thing. It was in American History X. It was
there
featured fairly prominently. It seems to be a lot of just screaming into a microphone.
Boy, I think that timeline lines up nice. So there is a chance that real big fish, and we don't know, folks, we're not saying this is the facts, but we're just saying there's a lot of evidence and people are saying that real big fish may be a secret neo-Nazi punk band.
Allegedly, we're just hearing things and we're reporting back to you on the things that we're hearing.
Yeah, we are not saying that's a fact. We're saying that we have heard it said by people.
I actually have a bone to pick with you about this song.
Okay.
A lot of times you get crazy sitcom dad-esque. You get these schemes in your head, these get-rich-quick schemes, make your own fireworks, start a podcast that will make me some sort of slave to a garbage schedule that we keep for no one. But you often say, and I'm quoting both you and the band Real Big Fish, everybody does it, and I wonder, why don't you? Everybody. Everybody does it. Maybe you should too, because you don't want to be left out. You want to be cool. Were you intentionally quoting this song when you tried to peer pressure me into things, or is that just a horrible coincidence?
Oh, I absolutely was quoting this song. Now, Tim, maybe I was wasting both our time. I thought for sure you knew that, and your love of Real Big Fish would seal the deal. The words themselves are vapid and meaningless. I can't imagine just those words swayed you. You didn't realize I was quoting what I thought to be a lifetime favorite band of yours? I mean, you saw them at Numbers, man.
No, it swayed me with your convincing argument. I may have seen a sex show at Numbers and also gotten some free cigarettes.
Right. I don't think you have to mention the cigarette part, because you had sex with a leather dog, so...
Okay, no.
So the cigarette thing's not that crazy.
Okay, current day Garrett, what do you do after sex? Cigarettes, right?
Nope.
Oh. No. Well, then movies from the 80s have lied to me. I thought I was supposed to be smoking cigarettes.
Maybe get some water, maybe a Gatorade. Tim, I mean, I've posed this question now for nary a year. What is your fuck style, Buck Wild?
I don't know what that question means.
TBD.
Yes.
Yeah. So maybe water's fine. Maybe you can enjoy smoking on a burning piece of plant. I personally gotta hydrate, to each his own.
Weirdly, so you mentioned the conga line thing here. Whenever they're shouting one of us, every time I've heard this song in the past,
I heard Lollipop.
I heard La La Bamba. La La Bamba.
Oh, god damn, dude. That's better than Lollipop.
Went really well with the conga line kind of thing.
It may turn into La Bamba.
Yeah.
I think they might be saying La Bamba.
Yeah.
La 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 Bamba. That makes way more sense, to be perfectly honest. Obviously more sense than Lollipop, but...
Less sense than one of us, given the racist lyrics included in this song.
And I just picked the least racist stanza. Song number 3, Join the Club.
There's a fair amount of shouting random, what I'm going to call ska phrases in this record. There's a lot of like, let's go, hit it.
Yep, it's the ska version of Rage Against the Machine.
Yes.
There's even some hoos, but not in this song.
Yeah.
But I think this one opens with a...
Yeah, it's ska scatting. Boy.
Yeah, this, what'd you call it?
Ska scatting?
Ska scatting?
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, I believe he moved on up to ska scatting.
It's a beautiful part of Maine.
Been some murders up there. Yes, it is ska scatting. So this song is not very good.
No, it is sort of the same song as Trendy. I hesitate to ask what you think the club is, given your explanation for what Trendy translates into.
Now, in this instance, they're just talking about starting yet another ska band in a sea of far too many ska bands.
They've got the lines, I want to go and start a band, but everything I want to do, it's already been done. Why would I want to go and do it again?
Yet here we are.
Yeah.
This is our first of many saxophone solos on this album.
Yeah. You know me, I fucking hate that instrument. I was forced to play it for several years whenever I was in middle school.
That's funny. So could you still play it today?
I mean, I have not played it since 1998, so probably not.
Is that why you were so into ska?
No.
Tim, were you in a ska band? Tim, were you in Real Big Fish?
No. However, I was in a, let's call it a movement, the late 90s. I was trendy, Garrett. I was super trendy.
Oh my god.
No, I was not a racist or a trendy person or a ska band member. Typically, I always think of ska as trumpets and trombones, which I am okay with.
Yeah, there's a time and a place. You know who does it pretty well? Ezra Furman. Ezra Furman does saxophone nicely. You know why, though? Because that saxophonist, he is completely comfortable with standing on stage for 4 out of 7 songs doing nothing.
He knows his fucking place.
You wait your turn, saxophonist.
Yeah. On Exile on Main Street, there's some good saxophone.
It accents things perfectly.
There's no saxophone solo overtaking the song.
I need not say another thing about this.
Track number 4, She Has a Girlfriend Now, featuring Monique Powell. She has a girlfriend now.
I like this song, Tim. It makes me laugh.
I have a question for you, though.
I probably have a similar question for you.
Does Lena Dunham approve of this song?
Oh, of course. That wasn't the question I had, by the way.
Oh, see, I have mixed feelings on that.
Why is that? How could Lena not appreciate somebody realizing their sexuality and not bound by normative gender roles?
Sure. He seems to be in support of the subject of their song being into women exclusively. He's certainly not homophobic. And the affirmation that she don't need no man is pretty empowering. However, after he sings about this empowered woman's decision that she does not need men, he decides, well, I never thought it would end like this, just because I've got no tits. I'll shave my legs, I'll wear a bra, I'd even cut my penis off for you.
Yeah.
Don't know if Lena's would appreciate this. See, because one, he's taking the transgender experience. He's not a transgender man or woman, I guess in this case, himself.
He's using it as a means to maintain a relationship where the other person has clearly moved on.
He is Rachel Dolezal-ing this situation?
Yes, he is Dolezal-ing his gender.
Also, I would like to state, I owe you a huge thank you for this song. Earlier this week, as I often do, I design a pretty elaborate costume for each one of these bands so that I can get more into the experience of listening to these albums. And for whatever reason, I got my mind set on this song as the inspiration for my costume. Garrett, being the good friend that he is, talked me out of it before I did some pretty permanent damage to my body.
Yeah, I came in, he was hovering over a mirror with a pair of kitchen scissors, and
Jesus.
Boy, my timing couldn't have been better, because I don't know what you were thinking, buddy. I appreciate the dedication to the show, but, well, it would have ruined the evening.
Yeah.
I had just gotten a pizza, we were getting ready to watch some Nicolas Cage movies, and instead we could have spent all evening in the hospital, and possibly to no avail. So,
yeah.
Your outfit today is, you know, honestly, for this show, pretty muted. The sideburns are nice, they're not, I don't want to know where you got that hair. It's not your hair.
No, it's Aaron's hair.
Oh, God.
Yep, got his hair. While we're on the subject, as a podcast, we should also state, if you think that somebody has told you that they are lesbian or gay, do not call their bluff by removing your own genitals. That can only end in heartache.
And genital ache.
Yeah, well, there will be some lingering pain. You're going to have to put a lot of Neosporin on that.
Some things even Neosporin can't fix. So, Tim, back to my question. And we should really inform the listener of the show. Maybe they didn't have time to hear the full album. She has a girlfriend now, has the lyrics. She has a girlfriend now. She said, guys, don't do no more for me. So it's about a gentleman that used to date a young lady who is now dating another young lady. Made me curious, Tim. I started thinking back on my life, and I wanted to ask you, how many of your former lovers are now lesbians?
I do not keep up with any of them. They will not respond to my texts. They don't answer the phone. It gives me like a weird... It seems like their phones are all disconnected.
Boy, that's the kind of block you need a government agency to sign.
So I'm not sure. I assume none, though.
Oh, I was going to say, if you had to ballpark it, you put it at zero.
Yeah, yeah. What about you?
Oh, somewhere around 16, I think.
Why, really? You've dated 16 women.
I didn't say that.
Oh, you've made love poorly to 16 women.
Nobody said it was poorly.
Their decisions post-coitus imply that coitus was not up to par.
Well, okay, so maybe I should take you through my thinking. 16 of them are not confirmed lesbians.
I don't know what that means.
That means that I don't know for a fact. I can't sign a court document declaring all 16 of them lesbians, okay?
But at least 16 women that you have dated or potentially had your gross way with.
Former lovers, too.
I am super uncomfortable with that depiction.
Hey, Tim, for the rest of this conversation, we're locking eyes.
All right.
Okay.
Let's talk about your former lovers.
Okay. So 16 of them I believe to be lesbians today. Like I said, I cannot sign off on all 16. I cannot legally state that. I suspect 16. I know of four. Two have experimented. And the rest, I assume, are lesbians because they broke up with me.
That's, I mean, a safe assumption. I'll give you that.
I mean, why else would you?
I can't think of a reason.
You're a good friend, Tim. You would tell me, is there a single reason that you would ever want to break up with me? If, of course, you were a woman dating me.
Let me ask you this. Do you think this plan that the protagonist of this song has to get a lady back, do you think that that would work on a straight man? Just hypothetically here, you have a straight buddy who's not into dudes. He's into ladies.
conceivable. I'm with you. Continue.
Do you think that if you acted in a way, again, strictly hypothetically, that right. the protagonist is suggesting here with the shaving the legs and the bra and the rest of it,
right.
do you think that would work?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
I do not. I want to be super clear about this. In your hypothetical, well, you just sank your eyes for just a second when I said hypothetical. I'm going to need you to lock it in, bud, okay?
Done.
In your hypothetical. All right, we're going to take it a third time. This time, do not break eye contact because we both know what it means. In your hypothetical, no. Your straight friend who's not into dudes would not be then into dudes if that dude was like a lady.
Okay, good to know.
Glad we got that covered. The song ends with a series of hoos and a man making what I can only describe as the sound of a record scratch, but with his teeth.
It's unnerving. Like,
there's a lot of vocal noise and sound effects just happening in this album. I think it still falls under the category of ska scatting.
Have you heard the Weezer song from Pinkerton, Pink Triangle?
Of course I have.
It's a very similar theme, a little bit less on the nose, but it might be more problematic. It's about a gentleman, a young man who is distraught over the fact that a lady he fancies is into ladies. If everyone's a little queer, can't she be a little straight?
That's not 2018 thinking.
No. I mean, that album came out about a month after this one, so there's no accusation of theft here, but it might be one of those great minds think alike. The Volcano, Dante's Peak, Armageddon, Deep Impact. The time was just right for this idea to blossom into popular culture, and blossom it did, Garrett.
It richly has blossomed and touched the lives of all of us, either personally or through people we know.
Yes.
And have walked in on and in an apartment you share with them.
Thanks to Garrett, we are not one of those. I was going to call us a couple, but I guess that's not right.
It's not right. We're barely friends. We are roommates, cohabitants.
Business?
We share a lease. Business partners. Well, that's not really true.
You've been quite clear about the not partners thing.
Track number 5, Snoop Dogg, baby.
I hate this song, Garrett. The first four I could give a pass to, but whenever you get to this song, fuck this album. This is so trash.
On my scorecard, I have it 2-2 coming into the fifth. Two of them I don't mind. Two of them I could thoroughly do without.
Compared to this song, though, those are all winners.
It's not a good song. This is about a man who gets sad when he hears gin and juice because he is a meme from a BuzzFeed article, I guess.
Is he implying that hearing the song Gin and Juice make him think of a specific lady?
Yes.
She sounds classy.
Well, I liked that album when it came out too, so that's possible.
Right.
I can understand how any song could make you think of somebody. I mean, maybe they made fun of it together for all you know. They may hate that song.
That's fair.
Very confusing saxophone solo in this song, and maybe an oboe.
That sounds right. Musically, the opening of this song sounds exactly like the NFL on Fox theme song. The... Yes, that's what this song is.
Yeah, exactly. I said, whoa. Well, now you're doing the final countdown, I think. It's the final countdown.
Not the final countdown, the NFL on Fox, but also maybe a little the final countdown, because that now that you're singing it, it also sounds right.
I don't know, but I know exactly what you're talking about. I called it a alternate take of a Rocky montage, but
sure,
same exact thing. Boy, it really does sound like the NFL.
And then it turns into the most reggae ska we've gotten on this so far.
So far, at least.
He does sublime rapping.
Well put.
It's not good.
That is to say, well, no, it's very bad. One of the only notes I have for this song is I am starting to sour on this album a bit. There's a lot of erratic change in tempo and tone throughout this song.
Oh, sure. That's them showing how diverse a band they are.
Track number 5 is a real stink pile.
Track number 6, Beer.
Did you read about the inspiration for this song, Tim?
I did, yes, but please.
The lead singer had noticed that a couple of his bandmates had taken to drinking beer. I'm not kidding, folks. And he thought it might be a good idea to write a song about said beer drinking. Simultaneously, he felt as though he would like to make a song that sounded like a Sublime song. This is one of two on this album that they shot for this lofty goal.
Not the only two that sound exactly like Sublime songs, so they did it accidentally, too. It does sound a lot like a Sublime song, specifically Santeria, although there's some doing time in there as well. I actually remember this song. I don't know if you're going to have ever heard this. The Texas country musician Cory Morrow had a cover of this song. It is worse.
Boy, I just barely missed that. I was on the Cory Morrow train 2 years before that.
I believe until you met him.
Well,
it's kind of a cunt.
I had waned a bit before I met him. And then when I met him, I was like, oh, you're a real cunt. Not as much of a cunt as Pat Green.
That sounds right.
I'm not going to cast any dispersions, but a guy I know heard from another guy who saw it with his own eyes. That man does a lot of cocaine, or at least does in 2002.
I like 2002's Pat Green, apparently.
Forgot about your penchant for cocaine.
This is one of the better songs on the album. I think we can agree on that.
I don't know.
It's one of the songs I hate the least on this album.
It is in my top four least hated songs on this album.
Okay.
Upper third.
There's a line on here that's either really upsetting or really sad. I couldn't figure out which. The lines are, she looks like heaven, maybe this is hell. Said she'd do it all again. She'd promise not to tell. Tell what? Tell who? Explain yourself, sir.
I spend a lot of time trying to understand this song, and I think that's why I hesitate to say it's one of my least hated songs on the album, because I can't really understand what the hell it's about. I think he's got an ex-girlfriend who is continuing to torture him to some degree. Did you get that impression?
I think she keeps like calling him to bang, but then won't get back together with him. That makes him sad. So he goes to the bar, and whenever he drinks, he makes friends. Kind of the opposite of a drunken Garrett.
I didn't hear where he made friends.
Oh, there's a lot of, and if you're drinking, well, you know that you're my friend kind of stuff. Like, I think
I thought he was talking to the girl.
I assumed it was like, I'm getting drunk with a bunch of strangers at the bar and we're all having a good time together after I'm very sad.
We need to explore two specific verses. The first being, and if I get drunk, well, I'll pass out on the floor now, baby, and you won't bother me no more. As we mentioned, this girl continues to call him and pester him. And so his solution is to get blackout drunk so he can't answer his own phone, which I think is a pretty smart solution.
You can change your number. Plenty of women seem to have done this to me.
I don't think they changed their number. I think that they have a court-ordered block on your number hitting theirs.
Oh, well, that also works.
They're not that hard to get, a little pricey, but if you get some decent evidence, and I am sure every one of them do, it's worth it. The other verse I want to talk about, though, is, and if you're drinking, well, you know, then you're my friend, and I say, I think I'll have myself a beer. So I thought, maybe he only likes her when he's drinking and she's drinking. I never got the impression he left, mostly because his goal was to pass out on his floor.
You might very well be right because, you know me, I can't be friends with women, mostly because women won't be friends with me. So I just assumed there were other dudes that he was friends with.
Tim, you are very unapproachable. Most of the time you're dressed up like some sort of weirdly obscure musician.
Right.
Or a character in one of their songs.
I'm quirky.
Do you know this is their most downloaded song?
It makes sense. Like, I'm surprised they didn't release this as a single.
Track number 7, 241.
Do we count this as an instrumental track?
I don't understand why they couldn't have just done that. There's a lot of scatting on here.
The scatting all seems to be just them saying 241.
Well, there's 241, but then there's a lot of like, wow!
Yeah.
And there's whispering into the microphone. You know how much I enjoy that.
Mm-hmm.
Fucked me. But we should mention, doesn't say that. The song is literally an instrumental track where they occasionally say 241. I really focused on just the music. It's not bad. It is not a song to be put on an album. It could possibly be used in like a Jim Jarmusch film where Bill Murray is searching frantically for a precocious child, maybe?
Yeah, I thought it sounded like a really good high school band. There is, I will give them this, there's some good non-ska trumpet played on this. Like, there's a trumpet solo that doesn't suck.
Their musical ability is not in question for me.
Sure.
Their choices are.
I don't really have a problem with this song for the most part.
Okay.
If you cut the vocals
241
completely out.
241.
Sure.
241. 241.
Oh, I want to kill you. And I want to kill Aaron. You know what really bothers me about this song?
What's that?
It is 2 minutes and 40 seconds long.
That is insulting.
Make it 2 minutes and 41 seconds, you fuck.
If you just got rid of them saying 241, do we even know what 241 stands for?
I assume it was their intended song length. Like, that's really what I think it was. And then they fucked it up or made it a second shorter as a bit. It sounds dumb enough to be accurate.
Track number 8, Everything Sucks.
The intros of all these songs sound identical to me.
With the exception of that random Monday Night Football one. By track 8, I realized that I have been beaten down by life to the point that I'm no longer of the personality or disposition to have this many horns in my life. You've got to be a very happy man for multiple horns. The happier the man, the more horn you can handle. Oh, I am a man of a single horn. I am a Miles Davis man.
I would say that's too much.
I get no horns?
You have no happiness. You have no joy, Garrett. There's just blackness within you.
This is very rude. Not germane to the album in one way or another. I think I am a single horn man. Maybe you're hornless.
No, I got some horns.
What do you, you think you're like some sort of like three horn man?
No, I get two. One on either side of me. I might just have tinnitus.
You have tinnitus. That's a different thing. What I'm saying is a metaphor.
Oh.
And that metaphor is for happiness, Tim. And I am a single horn man. Whereas this song, about everything sucking somehow, has many horns. This album has too many horns. And by track number 8, I am horned out.
I tend to agree. This song seems like a song that's intended to be empowering for men. Kind of an incel thing. There's a lot of lyrics on this whole album to the effect of, I don't need her anymore, or I'm better off without her.
I think you have really hit on something kind of important. We have to take note, and for those of you who might be a new listener, occasionally on the show, I will recite poetry I wrote as a high school student that sounds eerily similar to lyrics on the albums that we talk about on this show. And while I don't have a poem that matches identically to this, I couldn't help but notice on this song, Tim, much of that poetry was written while listening to this song.
Oh my God.
Some of the lyrics in here, she said someday we'll get back together, maybe. And she said someday things will be much better, baby. But I don't believe her.
That does sound like you, with the exception of you were never together in the first place. But everything else checks out.
Right, but as we have mentioned on previous episodes, I was guilty of building a bit of a straw man relationship or girlfriend.
Yes.
That is to say, I filled clothing with straw and carted it about.
To make love to.
Well, brought it with me here and there. Shower.
Yeah. You were making love to that moldy straw. Jesus Christ.
That straw's not a lesbian now. This song sounds like some sort of bizarre bet between the Bare Naked Ladies and Cake to see who could sound less good. It's a weird amalgamation of bass and talk singing, lamenting the nihilistic viewpoints of youth.
You had a much different youth than I did. I feel like I was optimistic and things were all looking up for Tim.
I was awash in hormones, Tim.
Oh, I was too. I assumed that someday those hormones would be put to good use. Yeah. But I was not meant to become a Chad, Garrett.
No, that wasn't in the cards for you.
No. Did you read anything of what Aaron Barrett said about this?
I don't think so.
About this, he said, our first album was actually called Everything Sucks, but this song was not on there. So I wrote this song in honor of the first album. I was going to make that our thing and always have a song on the next album that was named after the last album's title. But it was a stupid idea, so I gave it up.
I sort of respect that. Recognized that he had a dumb bit and he bailed on it.
If only I could find the courage to do the same thing.
No, you just dig yourself into a deeper and deeper hole that I have to edit around later. Track number 9, SR.
This is just more bad fake Jamaican accents and Sublime theft. Who the fuck is stealing from Sublime? Did bands look up to Sublime in the 90s?
I fear they did. Did you find out who SR is?
Suburban Rhythm?
Yeah, did you do some research on them?
Oh, I just assumed it was the rhythm of the suburbs. I had no idea that it was a thing.
But they then named very specific people as a member of the band Suburban Rhythm.
Whenever they said, why did Ed and Scott quit? I thought they were saying, why did F. Scott quit? And I thought it was an F. Scott Fitzgerald reference. That took me down a weird path. Yeah, which I did not get. I assumed that Ed and Scott were previous members of this band that had quit.
No, they were the former bandmates of the early 90s ska band Suburban Rhythm, which I kind of encourage people to go check out. It's arguably better than this. It's more original than this, that's for sure. So what do you think this song is about, not knowing what Suburban Rhythm is? What did you think they were singing about?
I really don't know.
But you thought Suburban Rhythm was the rhythm of the suburbs.
That's right.
Can you explain to me and the listeners at home what the rhythm of the suburbs are?
Oh, sure, Garrett. It's ska. Ska. Ska is the music of the suburbs in the 90s, as the same way gangsta rap was the music of the urban centers in the 90s.
What a stark contrast.
Yeah. This song seems like a bad self-cover of Sell Out or Trendy. This was another song that was intentionally influenced by Sublime. They were trying to make a Sublime song.
Yep.
So whenever I saw them live, I remember them playing this song because they played it and then they stopped and then they played it in a straight punk genre. Then they did a blues version of it. Then they did a disco version of it. Then they did a country version of it. Then they did a death metal version of it. Then rap, then backwards. It was genuinely impressive.
That sounds pretty good.
It was great.
And it points to maybe the biggest tragedy of this album. I think they might be really good musicians that just picked the worst genre ever.
It's like an 8-piece band that has all the tools there to make good music. Part of the problem, I think, is that they have this everyone has to play on every song kind of thing.
Yeah.
That drives me crazy. I mean,
right. Again, you've got to have bandmates that are willing to just stand there on stage or go backstage and get themselves a Fresca when they're not needed.
Track number 10, Ska Tanic.
Do you think it's Ska Tanic?
What do you think it is?
Skatanic. Like satanic, but ska-tanic? Skatanic?
I was thinking more of like Titanic, but with ska.
You remember what this song's about though, right? There's no boats.
Does Satan make an official appearance though?
No, but maybe. Who's the main character of this song?
I don't know. This song takes a weird turn from everything that comes before it.
Let's break it down. Where do you want to start?
Watching you sleep.
I'm looking in your window, and every day I drive past your house, standing in your front yard. Why don't you come out? Okay, now we're going to take a pretty harsh tone to this song, but I do want to point out, Tim, watching you sleep, I'm looking in your window, every day I drive past your house, standing in your front yard. You do all these things to me.
Fuck you, bitch. I love you. I'm not crazy.
Is that in the song? You know, you and I have come to blows many a time, but just then, you saying, fuck you, bitch, I wasn't ready for that at all.
No one ever is.
It's not how you talk to me.
Yeah, I think we should remove ourselves from this situation because it doesn't help us to dissect the song if you're saying, oh, yeah, Tim's watching me sleep because I live at your house. It's normal for me to watch you sleep. We sleep in the same room. We sleep in the same room. Garrett, if you go to sleep before me, I can't turn the TV on. That's going to wake you up, right? I have nothing to do except watch you sleep. It's not weird. Right. I think we should
Okay. Let me agree. I'll agree with you there. I will agree. However, why do you first go outside the apartment, scale the side, and then peek in the window?
It just feels more cinematic to me. Like, I'm picturing whenever somebody makes the movie of our life, and
why,
they will.
Why would they do that?
Oh, Garrett, there's some shocking turns up ahead for both of us.
Does it have anything to do with Vietnam? Also, the other thing, when you get home every day and you scream from outside, I'm here, you've got to stop.
I have walked in on some things that I can't forget. I want to make sure you know that I'm coming. The problem is, it kind of actually bothers me more because if I walk into the apartment and I see what I see, we can both pretend it's an accident. But whenever I yell, I'm going to come inside, and then you're still doing your bad thing, we can't pretend. That was intended for me to see. Anywho,
sure, I do it right.
So watching you sleep, nowhere to hide. One of these days, I'm going to come inside. Must be love. What else could it be? And then, of course, fuck you, bitch. I love you. I'm not crazy.
Don't be afraid to feel my touch. Don't worry, babe. I won't hurt you much. What is this song about?
You know, right?
I think so.
Yeah, it's about rape and murder.
Well, we don't know about murder. We don't know about rape. It could be one or the other. It doesn't necessarily have to be both. I'm going to make you love me, no matter what you say. Here I come.
And there's a woman screaming halfway through?
Absolutely. There's an assault recorded on this song.
Peppered in here, there are these really brief, maybe 2 or 3 second solos that are just in the public domain, but are songs that we all know.
I think that is a byproduct of performing live. What was once like, oh, look what I squeezed in there when we were playing live. That was fun. And now he does it every time. I think that I might be coming to the realization, Tim, that ska is the improv of the music world.
That doesn't make me like it more.
Well, no. And that is to say, there's quite a bit out there. Most of it is unbearable. And there's a very small, very specific, wildly talented, and so much better than the next rung down that it's not even like they're doing the same thing.
Who is the Andy Daly of the ska world?
I don't know that I know ska well enough to answer that.
But you believe there to be somebody that is that good?
Yes. I think a lot of it has to do with the arrangement. I think you've got a lot more flexibility in your ska group arrangement than this band lets on. And if you get the right mix of horns and guitar, maybe some keyboard, for God's sake, and maybe a lead singer that actually sings and doesn't sing talk at you, you might have something. But these are not singers. Their songs sound remarkably similar. There's too many horns. There's just too many horns. Yeah. I've been over this. Stop with the horns. And now we've got some guy who's raping and murdering women. That's not a song, Tim. I want to point out, in my pre-song pump-up mix, I never played this song.
I don't believe that.
Well, okay.
Why would you skip this one song?
It doesn't get me pumped. The whole point was to get pumped for that run.
Okay, so
Tim, I was trying to go to state.
Did you make it to state?
Of course I did.
Congrats. Did you win state?
No, I didn't eat properly and I got diarrhea.
So no meatball sub directly before the race that day.
Right. I substituted 4 bowls of cereal.
Oh, yeah. If your diet is nothing but meatball subs, any variation is going to give you some pretty bad diarrhea, which really is what your body needs, but it is not convenient during a run.
No, it isn't. It was especially muddy, too. You actually had to tape your shoes to your feet.
See, no, that actually works because you could just cover it up and say, no, that's mud. That's not my own shit. Is that what you did?
If I could have, I would have. The issue is that I still was running fast enough that my bowel would not release.
Then I don't believe saying you had diarrhea is accurate.
Oh, I did. I ran through that finish line and into a porta potty.
Okay, let me ask you this. Do you believe that a person with diarrhea can run so fast that it keeps their diarrhea inside? Because I think that is very bad advice to be giving to our listeners.
I'm not saying this is a foolproof plan to keep from diarrheaing yourself. I believe part of the issue was that it came on like a mile in. If you're coming from a place of diarrhea, sure. You're not going to be able to even get up to speed. But if you are at speed when you get the diarrhea, you're going to stay clenched. You're going to hold. So if you can get up to speed before it hits, yes, I think you can abstain entirely.
And okay.
In my case, if I could have let it go, I would have.
But we as a podcast are not suggesting that diarrhea be treated with running.
No, no, no. If you find yourself at home, take an Imodium, maybe some Pepto. Honestly, the best thing is to elevate your knees and just let it happen. But make sure to stay hydrated. And for God's sake, if you already have diarrhea, don't then go run. You'll shit everywhere.
Do not go run unless it's muddy and you can play it off as you just got a little extra muddy.
Don't do that, though. Track number 11, All I Want Is More.
Did you figure out what the horn intro to this was from?
Nah, it didn't stand out like that to me. What did stand out is just how similar ska is with Tejano music, replacing an accordion with an overstuffed brass section. This song is about a guy who really sucks.
Yeah, an incel. It's a weird incel fantasy.
Tim, I asked you on mics. We paused briefly. I asked you to please stop with the incels, but I'm glad you kept with it, buddy, because you're 100% right. And this one's a very interesting version because he seems to be some sort of subordinate. The lyrics are, why can't she make up her fucking mind? I'm just here wasting so much time. I know it's my fault. It's not my problem anymore. Someday, maybe she'll come back to me. So if I read that right, this is about a guy who's spending a lot of time around a girl in the hopes that she'll come back to him and they previously dated because he still loves her and she does not appear to love him, but is taking advantage of the situation, keeping him on the hook to do her favors and such.
There's this weird fantasy part next, though, but it is at least couched in some self-awareness. It goes, someday, maybe she'll come back to me, and I'll say, why don't you go fuck yourself? But everybody's talking. They know that I'm lying. He knows the right thing to do in this situation would be to be like, absolutely not, we're not getting back together. But he knows he would.
Yeah, he is incredibly sad. I kept picturing a guy like sitting in his car in a Walgreens parking lot while this chick goes to pick up a pregnancy test and she can't pick which one. And he's just like, why am I even here? But she doesn't want to freak out the new guy. He's a bit of a Chad, kind of a cool guy.
Yeah, want to keep them around.
So she's asked her old buddy to, can you give me a ride? And she wants emotional support, even though they're not dating at all. And as you pointed out repeatedly in a myriad of offensive ways, the incel community is not having sex. It's right there in the name, involuntarily celibate. Yeah, that's kind of what I kept picturing. And at that point, I didn't even realize we were dealing with a possible incel situation. They wrote it about some sad boy who's being emotionally manipulated by a woman that can tell she can get what she wants because she's 16 and has no conscience. I'm just spitballing. I'm just going off the facts I read in the song. No personal experience injected into that hypothesis.
No, and you could tell that that was purely objective. By the way, tears are streaming down your face as you say.
They can't see it. Yeah.
Track number 12, Nothing.
Full punk song, right?
Yeah, it's at least a break from the ska.
What's funny to me is this album was around me at such a transformative time in my life. As I mentioned, I may or may not have been dealing with some difficulties with making friends on account of having zero cultural touchstones in order to bond with them over. They were very interested in football, and I could quote a lot of movies. That was helpful.
Yeah, you knew Bill Murray.
That's true. I feel like this song may have helped to contribute to that weird, hardened, soulless thing I became there for a bit. There's lines in here where he just screams, I don't fucking care.
Screams it 18 times, actually.
Oh, that's too many. But I could see me relating to that at that age. I mentioned that it is kind of a punk song, but that is not to say that eventually it does just settle into that cool reggae jam with a bass slap. They can't help themselves. We're 12 songs in, Tim. Being generous, I think I'm at a 6-6 split. Six that I can tolerate, six that I think are just trash.
I think it's less than that for me.
You think it's 7.5? I'm going to give you 7.5. You got three songs that there's at least a chance they can turn this thing around for you.
There is, but there's less and less hope that that's going to happen.
All right, let's keep it moving then. Track number 13, Say 10.
This is apparently the Winston's Amen Brother of song titles, and I just never knew it.
Hardly that popular, but I understand what you're saying. Were you a little disappointed to learn that this was not like our friend Marilyn Manson's song about the Dark Lord Satan himself?
In all honesty, I think the Marilyn Manson song is a better song simply from the standpoint that it was as advertised. This is an anti-PETA song, maybe?
At first, I thought it was pro-vegetables, but now I think it's just anti-vegetarian?
I don't think he is seriously defending the feelings of vegetables, if that is your assertion.
No, I don't think he's doing it sincerely. I think somebody maybe should.
We don't know what they're feeling. If you feel bad for a clam or a fish, something that doesn't have a thalamus, I don't think you can say...
Wait, is that how we're gauging sentience?
No. That's how we're gauging pain.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. Gotcha.
I mean, because presumably it would have to pass through the thalamus. It doesn't really matter. You can't say for sure that there is no version of pain that a plant feels whenever you chop it down.
Let's even take pain out of the equation. Let's just go with a plant's ability to react, not even say comprehend, react to stimulus around it. If I eat a bunch of clams next to clams, those clams aren't going to do anything. If I eat a bunch of plants next to some plants, they will change their molecular structure to become bitter, thus making me less inclined to eat those plants.
Is that why my second helping of vegetables always tastes worse to me?
I don't think so.
Sounded like what you were saying.
It's so far from what I was saying. How did you...
I like vegetables in small quantities up front. But if I then go back for a second helping of vegetables, they don't taste as good. And I'm wondering if it's because the second vegetables, again, these are, of course, cooked vegetables, it's eating raw vegetables, they don't taste as good. And I'm thinking it might be a defense mechanism.
It's not. They're
as you hypothesized.
They're already dead.
Uh-huh.
I wasn't talking about vegetables specifically. And I think you're just eating too much. Or you're overcooking your vegetables. Do you continue cooking them while you eat the first batch?
I leave them on the stove, yes.
I guess they're oversteaming.
Yeah, you know what? They might be burnt afterward. That might be what the bitter is coming from.
Yeah, you're just burning food.
You know what, Garrett? Put two heads together, you can solve anything. Well done, friend. We did it together.
Tim, how many times have I screamed from the living room bedroom, Tim, you're burning your vegetables. Please go take them off the stove.
And then I do put my second helping on, and they're not as good. And I thought, well, just now I thought, whenever you mentioned that fact I'd never heard before, that it might be due to some sort of protective
mechanism. We all know what you thought, you fucking idiot. Stop wasting everyone's time. At the end of this song, he says, save a plant, eat a cow. I want beef. I want it now. I'm going to eat it because it's red. I'm going to eat it because it's dead. Maybe I should eat it raw. Let the blood run down my jaw. I'd eat people if it was legal.
It gets a little weird in those last couple of lines.
It does, but I do have to ask, and I think I know the answer, so you better be honest. If it was legal, how many people would you eat?
A year?
What?
Well, I mean, if it was...
I did not expect you to answer with a passage of time.
Well, I mean, if it's legal, how many cows do you eat a year? Like 7? 20? I don't know, but a lot.
Yeah, how many do you eat?
Less than that.
You probably eat 7. I eat 20.
I assume it would be proportional to the cows, right? You would probably eat...
60 men.
Yeah. Full-grown men. Not babies. You're not a monster. Fucking veal.
I don't eat red meat for every meal, though.
Well, sure. Whenever you do eat it, you eat a good 2 pounds in one sitting.
Yes. I do eat it 2 pounds at a time. Minimum.
No, exactly. Yeah, I mean, it would probably be quite a few.
You have answered this in such a fascinating way. I was really posing the moral question, how many people would you feel comfortable eating? Whereas I think you have tackled this more from a logistical standpoint, and you feel as though you would be eating somewhere in the neighborhood of, what, 35 men?
If eating people is legal, I'm presuming...
Yeah, let's go PPY, people per year.
Yeah, so, I mean, less than you, but still more than the average American, definitely.
What I'm really trying to drive home here is there's no scenario where it's zero.
No, absolutely not. If it's legal to eat people, I'm gonna do that.
Because I was really more answering your question initially there of how many could you eat, which is interesting that you went there immediately. My question was really, would you?
Yes.
Yes. Oh, that's clear. So you would eat somewhere around 35 to 40 men.
I think as long as you could guarantee me no one would find out, I could be persuaded to eat a person if it was not legal.
Oh my God, this has taken a terrifying turn. How often do you think about eating me?
You would not be my first choice. Let's just put it that way.
I mean, that's very rude. You eat pork.
Yes.
You think my diet is worse than that of a swine?
Yeah. They feed those.
Wow. You didn't even hesitate.
they feed those a very specific diet so that they have their meat has a consistency. You're out there. You're mixing it up. And this is not a slight against you.
Feels like it.
You're out in the world. You're rock climbing. You're getting bit by dogs. It's going to be a very gristly, tough meal. I don't think I'd want to eat that at all. I think I would... I'd much rather go for somebody more sedentary.
Yeah,
not a big fat guy, but like...
No, not a big fat guy. I don't want marbling.
But you don't want it to be tough, I think, is where we're both of us are at, right?
Right.
This whole song sounds like a Ted Nugent cover of Dr. Seuss. I'm gonna eat it because it's red. I'm gonna eat it because it's dead. Maybe I should eat it raw. Let the blood run down my jaw.
Seussian to the core.
The other thing is, there is a Pop Goes the Weasel solo in this song.
Yeah, there really is, isn't there?
That's weird.
It's weird. It's sad.
It's confusing. Don't put that on your fucking record.
So I'm at a hard 7.5 now. 7, I do not like at all. 5, I like to tolerate.
But there's been 13 songs.
Oh, then I'm at 8.5.
All right. Track number 14, I'll Never Be.
Everybody's looking at me. Thought I saw my face on MTV.
I hate this song.
See, that's interesting. I do too, but I'll Never Be. That sounds like the name of a Garrett poem.
That would have been a great young Garrett poem. But no, because he builds quite an imaginary world of things that will never happen. Here's the difference, Tim. This guy is lamenting the things that shall never be. Whereas a lot of my poetry seemed to be about relationships that I at least thought I would end up having, whereas in reality, they would never be.
Right. Someday when you hit that growth spurt and stop having cross-country diarrhea,
you'll get the girl. Much.
And you did, Garrett. That's the great thing about your story. Eventually, almost 36 years after that, track experience.
Not.
But
no,
the point
not.
Is, Garrett, focus on the positive here. You did get the girl. Everything worked out for you. I mean, you're living in a studio apartment with me.
Right.
And that's not ideal for either of us.
It could be, though. There are two completely made up, fully furnished guest bedrooms that we could be sleeping in.
Garrett, no.
I know we've had this conversation and you seem pretty firm on it, so I don't want to fight you on it, but I don't understand it. These futons smell.
Well, one
terrible.
Of them smells quite a bit like paint.
Yeah, that's because you painted on my futon.
I'm glad.
My couch bed has never been the same. It's rough. Did you know paint's rough?
Yes. That's why I didn't
cold.
Do it on my couch bed.
We don't have heat. That paint is freezing.
Yeah, we also don't have windows. Well, working windows.
Who paints windows open?
I had the spray paint. It doesn't matter. We're blaming people. We're pointing fingers, and I don't think that's productive. Let's
Did
move
you
on.
Do it? Did you do it? Did you paint our windows open? This is news.
Let's move on to track number 15, Alternative Baby.
I got two theories here. One is, I think, very obvious. This is a song about a gentleman hitting on the women at his concerts. Or there's a chance this is about a gentleman in the crowd of a neo-Nazi punk rally.
Definitely
that. Who is smitten with a with a skinhead woman. And the lyrics go, "Well, I see you up on stage, and I don't know just what you're saying, but you're my hero. But a guy just kicked me in the head. A little girl just passed out dead. I'm in between a big jock and a sweaty skinhead, but I love you."
That's interesting. I never considered the idea that the girl he was interested in was a skinhead, but I like the idea that he doesn't realize she's a skinhead. He thinks she's just quirky. The chorus here, "Hey, little alternative girl, said, don't you want to be my friend? You know, I'm singing all my songs for you." He calls her little alternative girl. In his mind, she shaved her head. She's a little different. Maybe, you know, she's a little punk rock. That's kind of cool. She's a racist.
Tattoos. Yeah. What are these lightning bolts?
She's a big fan of Hitler. That's what she's into. Not ska. Hitler.
Skittler. We might have just written our own hell. Welcome to hell. This is Skittler. It's all Hitler-based ska.
No, it's all ska-based Hitler speeches.
Wait, so those are Hitler-given speeches about ska?
That's right.
Is it the history of ska or how much he loves it?
We're going to be there for a while, Garrett. He's going to wear the subject out. Everything will be discussed.
Will it ever deviate from the topic of ska?
Absolutely not. They're Skittler speeches.
That's true. I don't know if I'd rather deal with Skittler speeches or Skittler band, because Skittler band is Hitler fronting a ska band. So you have eternity, and as far as I know, Hitler does not know how to play ska, or at least didn't on the date of his death. So I assume on day one of hell, he is learning how to play in a ska band. And you have all of eternity to watch him get good at ska, but no one's going to teach him.
Oh, he'd get so good.
Would he, though, with nobody teaching him?
Eventually. Eternity.
What if it was your job to teach Hitler how to play ska music?
But
you cannot play anything for him. You have to just explain it. Welcome to hell. On your first day, you will be assigned a buddy. Congratulations, Timothy Richardson. Your buddy is Adolf Hitler.
Hello, we are going to learn ska.
Hello and welcome to hell. Your demise will be truly horrific. Your task for eternity is teaching Hitler ska.
I'm very excited.
I assume his English would be pretty good by now. Or, you know, the date of your death, when you go to hell to teach Hitler ska.
Are you trying to will this into being by saying
I don't need to.
Okay.
The Dark Lord will handle things for me, and your haphazard approach to safety should take care of the rest.
Bad news, friend. My haphazard attention to safety will likely, or as likely, be the death of you as me. Track number 16, Cool Ending.
I did not know this was a thing.
That's probably for the best. This is the same song as All I Want Is More and Nothing. Well, so glad you're gone. You led me on. Where did it go wrong? I didn't care anyway. Just wanted to say, we'll be friends. That just means no sex. I don't care what you say. I'm tired of fucking you anyway. Everything is cool. I wish you were dead.
Content-wise, yes, very similar.
Okay.
But am I crazy? It didn't sound like ska, did it?
It is genuinely deviation from the exact sound of all the other songs.
I mean, in fact, that opening guitar sounds a little bit like a little band you and I know called Neutral Milk Hotel. I had no idea it was there. I owned this CD for over 20 years. That's the end of the album, which brings us to How Did It Do?
This was their best-selling album. It is currently certified gold by the RIAA, which means that it has sold between 500,000 and 1 million copies. It peaked at number 57 on the Billboard 200 in September of 97, so that's 13 months after it was released. It eventually did kind of okay.
Yeah, I'm sure they made some money. Not enough, clearly, because they just keep releasing albums.
Most of them being greatest hits albums.
It was a modest success. What did people think of it?
Critics in general, the ones that bothered with it, seemed to like it. On Amazon, The Man on the Street, there's 156 total reviews. It had a 4.5 out of 5-star average, 81% 5 stars, 2% 1 star. The first review I have for you today is by Ben Mann, or Scottanical at redacted.com. It's titled, Great Way to Start a Ska Collection. This is from 1999. Real Big Fish's Turn Off the Radio was the first real ska CD I bought back in 96. Since then, I've collected about 70 ska CDs. This is still my favorite, next to LTJ's Losing Streak. There is some great songwriting, great horns, and great singing. There is some of the best songwriting I've ever heard, even though none of it is really serious. Remember, the Beatles started out with the same type of songwriting, and look where they ended up. If you're already a ska fan, you either have this CD or you've heard every song twice from a friend. But if you're not a ska fan, this is the first ska album you should get. 5 out of 5 stars.
So we need to go find Real Big Fish's like 2002 album. Looking for their Rubber Soul White Album era.
Right, but this guy is predicting a Beatles-like career for them, and he's doing so in 1999.
All right, that's why we need to see where it landed.
To see if he's correct.
Maybe.
Could we maybe just not do this? And
yeah, let's not do it. Let's assume that they didn't. And that guy who gave us his email address, I'm writing him.
You should. Next review, it's called, If You Don't Buy This CD, You're Freaking Nuts. It's good. Look, just buy the CD, okay? Man, why would you read these reviews anyway? Stop being such a wuss and buy the CD. Man.
I've never seen a one-sided argument written out. That's so weird.
This is by Jordan G. It's called Just Can't Explain It from 2005. Oh my God, this was my first Real Big Fish CD. I got it back in 2001, and I'm still not even an ounce sick of it. There is literally not one song that is not better than any band's best song. Please buy this CD and brighten your day.
Wow. It's good to see he didn't get too hyperbolic there. Good Lord.
This is by David Butcher. It's entitled One of the Greatest and Most Humorous CDs in the World from October 1998. I got this CD for Christmas last year. I had only heard one song off of it before getting it. Within one time of listening to the whole CD, it made me realize that there is more to music than what you are forced to listen to on the radio. Now, I rarely listen to the radio, and I have finally discovered my own taste in music, not the music that I have to listen to while riding in the car with my mom. I got their new CD, Why Do They Rock So Hard Today, and I already love it. I can't wait until I learn all the words to this CD. So thank you, Real Big Fish, for helping me see that I don't have to like what my mom likes. 5 out of 5 stars. I hope he's 42.
I'm super glad he found Real Big Fish so that he could learn the life lesson that you do not have to like everything your mother likes. Guy's just sitting at home watching Designing Women, enjoying a nice toasty cardigan.
All those things seem nice. You love a good cardigan, and I love Designing Women. I think it might be a different thing than what you're talking about, though, now that I say it out loud. Let's move on.
Tim, who's this for?
It's for you and me when we were 12 to 15. Again, though, obviously two decades apart.
For me, I'm going to call it 14 to 16.
Okay. I mean, it's for 42-year-old people that are still riding in the car with their mom and are just fucking sick of her music. It's for people that don't really respect the Beatles too much.
Or maybe haven't heard all of the Beatles' work.
Maybe they just heard side B of Please Please Me. No, you know what? That's still way, way, way better than this.
Let's take it to the final thoughts. What have we not said about this album?
It's so catchy. This is going to be stuck in my head for a long time, and that's another one of these fuckers' crimes.
I am pleased that it finally got LMFAO out of my head.
Carrie Underwood did nothing on that front.
Carrie Underwood just passed like a ship in the night, in one ear, right out the other. I can't even remember her name half the time. I keep calling her Lizzie McGuire. I don't even know who that is.
We'll do her album next week. Stay tuned for Lizzie McGuire.
I assume she doesn't have one.
I think it's Mark McGuire's wife or daughter, maybe.
Why would I be talking about her?
Why? I don't know, Garrett.
I don't like ska.
I
don't like the guy who liked this, the younger version of myself.
I don't like him either.
All right, nobody asked you if you liked the younger version of. You never met him. You don't know.
I know, Garrett. You have introduced me to that guy on numerous occasions, and he sucked.
He did suck. God, yeah. I sucked.
I don't like ska. For the most part, I'm not a don't really like reggae. But yeah. I really don't like this white guy reggae. It's insulting. It's bad. It's just out of their wheelhouse. It's not good.
Right. It's an impersonation. It is mediocre ska, and that's not what your ska can be. It's either got to be the best ska there is or no ska at all.
Preferably the latter.
Well, you also can't spend half of your album talking about how all the best ideas are already taken and you don't stand out in the bunch, but you're willing to sell out as long as everybody likes you.
Yeah, fuck them.
They want to... Yeah. Oh, boy. All right. Well, I think that primes the pump, Tim. Let me ask the question. Do you hate this album?
I was all prepared to say, no, I can't. Like Blink 182, they kind of don't take it seriously enough. I'm pretty angry at them, though. I don't.
Interesting.
I'm going to be singing these songs for the next month, and I hate pretty much all these songs. I feel like you're going to scream that at me every time I fall asleep. Get right in my face. I mean, on the whole, I kind of hate this album, Garrett. Kind of hate
it. Okay. I'm going to allow a kind of hate.
I think you got me there, though. We can give you credit, at least, for having gotten me there.
None needed, but thank you.
In my scorecard that I keep on the fridge, I'm going to mark you down as a plus one.
Okay. I don't know what that means.
What about you? Did you hate this?
No.
Ah! Damn it.
I don't hate this album, Tim. I don't like it. I don't think I can ever listen to it again. Maybe in 10 years I can listen to She Has a Girlfriend Now. That's kind of funny. But the rest of it, no. And in fact, it might have soured me on ska in general.
I think you are already pretty sour on that.
That's true. I don't hate it. Enough of it is competent, and it doesn't sound enough like Sublime to really drive me crazy. I can fully support you kind of hating it. And if I didn't have the nostalgia pull, I think I'd be there too.
Yeah, I mean, that's a big thing. Because while I do have a certain amount of nostalgia for this band, it's not directly tied to this album.
When we do another one of their albums that you know and I don't, I'll be curious to see where that lands.
All right.
I think that's going to wrap it up. As always, guys, we really appreciate the emails, the Twitters, the Instagrams, the Facebook posts. Keep them coming. Tell your friends, tell your mom, tell your grandma, tell your dog. We don't care. Just download the show, please. You can reach out to us, as always, at hatepod.com. Click on the contact link in the upper left-hand corner. You can email us at hatepodmail@gmail.com, or you can reach out on Twitter at @albumhatepod, Instagram at hatepod, or facebook.com/hatepod. Tell us what you think of the show, what you like, what you don't like. Write a review, for the love of God. They make such a big difference, and we really do appreciate it. The emails are awesome. Tim, did I leave anything out?
I kind of zoned out a little bit there, maybe.
We'll assume I didn't. For Why I Hate This Album, I have been one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey.
I have been and continue to be the other, Tim Richardson.
The riffs are too repetitive, the lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides and the cover art's a mess. There's so much here to tear apart. Listen to it for a week, now that we pass past. Why I Hate This Album podcast with Tim and Garrett.